Thank you for coming. I'm very happy that we have Jesper Osmund here with us today. He's already here for a couple of days. What we did already is a rough cut workshop for Croatian documentaries that are in a rough cut stage. So editors and directors of those films got some good advices how to structure the film better and how to finish the editing. Because this is also something that Jesper does. He's a consultant around many workshops around Europe. So he will speak also not only about his editing work, but also about his consultancy work. Denmark is a very famous country for its editors. There are a lot of really, really excellent editors in Denmark. And we were speaking yesterday, I was wondering, what is the reason? How come they have so many really excellent editors? And he told me that it comes from a Danish tradition. So I hope that Jesper will tell us also what is this Danish excellent tradition of editing. And I'm really happy that we have him here today. Please interrupt with questions, ask whatever you want to know, and welcome to Jesper.
Thank you very much for your kind invite. I do a lot of workshops. I love to do rough cut workshops. I love to meet films at half stages. I enjoy to see people and their faces burning with frustration and not knowing what to do next. Masterclasses is not the ones I enjoy the most, so be kind to me. I do not mind questions, but raise a hand because I might be able to find the right spot to take the question. How many of you saw Bananas? Ah, okay. I'm not going to speak a lot about it, but I'm going to talk a little about the background about the film and why it ended up being like that. But first of all, I would just give a little background about me, because I never imagined myself as a film editor. I was a brilliant student, and I thought I was supposed to be a scientist. So I started studying biochemistry. And I'm actually just lacking one math exam from having a bachelor in biochemistry. And that's when suddenly I realized that there is something lacking here. And I was afraid that that thing, whatever it was, because I didn't know what it was, it might be haunting me for the rest of my life, so I just stopped. And I got a job in a nightclub full time, so working 6 nights a week, getting in at 10 o'clock in the evening and out in the morning at 7 o'clock in the morning. But then I thought that I was lacking something for my head. I always liked to read a lot. As a kid, I read tons of books. I had this very dear friend of mine who said, "Oh, Jesper, if I had the grades that I know you have, I would study film at the university." And then I told her, and I asked her, I said, "But what do they do there?" "They just watch a lot of films." So that's what I did. I signed in and they accepted me. And I met all these fellow students who were really cinema aficionados. And I heard a lot of words that I had absolutely no idea what was. Truffaut, Buñuel, everything, I had no idea. I went very little to the cinema as a child. It was just some Walt Disney with the family and maybe a hideaway with my big brother to watch a James Bond film, and that was it. But I started to watch a lot of films from all different periods, the whole history. And I thought it was fascinating. I still didn't have any idea what I would do afterwards with it. It was kind of a hobby while I was thinking what to do with my life, because I knew I was not going to be a bartender for the rest of my life. But then we started making small productions. And at one point, they had to be edited. And that's when suddenly I realized, oh, there's an entire world here that is fascinating. So I started to hunt up professional editors to see if I could start working as an assistant. And I found one who was actually who graduated as a film editor but was also working as a director. So he was editing his own films. And I came on as an apprentice. This was on the old Steinbeck tables. This was with celluloid, 16mm or 35mm. And normally, when you have those situations, you would have a director lying on the couch in the back screaming. Then you would have the editor sitting in the table in front. And then you would have the poor assistant sitting, trying to keep hold of all the bits and pieces that the editor would throw over his shoulder. A finished feature film is 2.8 kilometers, 2,800 meters. But normally you would shoot for a Danish feature film, you would shoot like 30, 35 kilometers. So you had a lot of pieces to keep track of. And that means you didn't really get into the conversation between the editor and the director, because you were so occupied with all your bits and pieces, and suddenly the editor would say, the kiss that I cut out Monday morning, now I want it again. And then you had to find that kiss. Find that 1.5 meter somewhere in all the stuff. But in my case, the director was editing himself. So he had no one to talk to, except me. So he was confronting me with all his considerations, when he was looking through the material, and then he would say, what do you think, Jesper? And I had no idea what to think. I didn't know what he was looking for. But slowly I started to get into this, okay, I have to have an opinion. And things went on. We worked for like 3 years together. The last time we worked together on the last couple of films, it was basically me sitting in the table and him screaming from the back on the couch. Not that I was the editor editing the film, but technically I could manage everything then. Then he passed away very early on, and I stood like, I didn't know what to do, because I was like in the middle of everything. And I was trying to get another mentor, and that was difficult. There was one that I had my eyes on, because he was quite, or still is, a very renowned editor called Janus. And I contacted him, and then he said, Jesper, I have the assistants I have, but can you physically edit? Can you manage the table? Can you control everything? I said, yeah. Then it's just a question to get as many meters through the table as possible. Whatever. Edit anything. And I think it was a good advice for me at that stage, and I think it's a good advice if there are any editing students here. Don't be picky on the topics, on the projects or whatever. Edit whatever, because there is a lesson hidden in everything. You cannot afford to be picky. So I started editing small artist films from workshop labs. And then suddenly, by coincidence, I won't bore you with the story, but suddenly I actually managed to be hired as the editor for a feature film. I was basically hired as the assistant, but we worked for quite a long time. It was almost a year and a half. And then the director was very fond of me. So, and at the end of the film, I remember when we had to see the first copy of the film in the lab, suddenly it said chief editor, Jesper Osmund. And basically I was the assistant, but he was like showing me this gift. He thought that my contribution to the film, the problem with the film was that it was a disaster. He was a brilliant guy, very entertaining guy, but he was actually more an artist as a film director. He was very fond of Godard, and he made the film. The film was shot in 1990. I edited it in 1991, and it premiered in 92, I think. But he was stuck in that Godard principles from the 60s, and it didn't really hit well on in 1992. And I remember I was sitting in the premiere. There was a whole... the whole row just in front of me, it was film students from the real film school, not from university, but from the real film school. I knew some of the faces, and I just remember how they all, when the titles went on, the credits went on in the end, all the heads, I remember it was, I felt like the entire cinema, all the heads just turned around and was looking at me and saying, what the fuck did you do with this film? And I had the impression, I will never work again. During my time as an assistant, I had made a friend, another editor, when we were editing in some of these studios with several editing facilities. You know, we met for lunch, and he was editing in the room beside me, and we went out to smoke together or had lunch together, and he liked me, and I was fond of him. He was very big. He's called Nils P. Andersen, and is a really, really renowned editor today. You heard Act of Killing and The Look of Silence, Three Rooms of Melancholia. And suddenly he called me when I thought I have to find another career. I said, Jesper, I want you to edit a film. I know the director. I've worked with him before on a couple of films, but I don't have time to do this one. I want you to do it. I said, okay, Nils, thanks a lot. What is the film? It's a documentary. A documentary. But I don't know where to start. No, but you will find out. And that was how it started. And he was kind of in the back, promising to come in whenever I felt totally lost in this chaos it can feel like when you enter such a process. And he did a couple of times, but it went well. And actually, from the moment I started, I felt it very liberating, because I had only worked on fiction up till then. And then you get a script, 90 pages, 1 minute per page. And it says the scenes, it says the dialogue, it even says in the when there is supposed to be a break. And then suddenly not having anything and having to make all these decisions and these discoveries for yourself, it was liberating. It was not intimidating. It felt intimidating in the beginning. And that was the beginning. I kept on working with Nils almost during the 90s. We worked separately, but we also edited several films together. Basically me doing the hard job and him coming in being the wise guy. But that was how my process started, with what I call the editing without a script. I have seen scripts in documentaries, but I don't like them. But I know that some film funds are actually demanding scripts, even for documentaries. It is hilarious, because it is simply a time waste for those poor directors who have to, out of their pure imagination, write a script to be able to compete with fiction film projects. I don't know why. And I've also seen examples of films I have come into that is a big problem, because they got funded because of a script that they wrote out of half imagination. So what do? They go film the bleeding script. So you have a problem. You don't have all that extra material, all that investigating interviews, because they just filmed the script. But working without a script, it is basically trying to find an order in all this chaos that is around you. And that was my experience from the first documentary. And you cannot be intimidated. I know it can be very overwhelming when you're sitting with all that material and you don't know whether to turn left or turn right. But you have to see it as a journey, and you have to believe that the whole process is going to be a journey and there is going to be given answers on the way. Because you cannot have all the answers from the beginning. It's impossible. You have to start somewhere. On top of all the chaos you have in the material, you have all the chaos inside the director's head. And that is your job as an editor. And that's what I learned from my first mentor, that he had to talk all the time. It was the conversation. Even though he knew I was only an apprentice, he wanted the dialogue. He needed to talk. Even though I was not very good at that point to drag things out of him or to investigate his inner vision, he was looking for it. And directors need that. You, one of the main functions for you as the editor, it is to provoke the director. Ask questions. Attack him. To see if you, or her, if you can open the mind and get closer to that vision. Because I must be honest, I have heard of these directors who know everything what they are doing and they're coming into the editing room and they have all the shots in their mind what they're doing. I'm sorry, I have never met one. I have heard that they exist, but I still have the pleasure, the dream of one day meeting one, but I haven't. These directors are human beings, with all the flaws and mistakes and confusions and frustrations that all of us are carrying with. And I have to respect it, but I have to attack and provoke him. Because that's the only way that I can get close to his inner vision, because very often they have never been really verbalized. They have been written, you know, in nice sentences on a piece of paper. But what does it mean when you really confront yourself with the material? Where is it, all these intentions, when you suddenly are sitting with the material? Where is the... So my point is that directors need editors just as much as the editors need the directors. It is a symbiotic coexistence in the editing room. It can be tough emotionally. I tell my directors to leave the coat outside the editing room. That means I do not want to hear about his wife who's screaming at him every morning. I do not want to hear about his new children. I do not. All that we can talk about outside. In the editing room, it's about the film. And only about the film. But my loyalty as an editor is split. Because I am the materials, the raw materials, first audience. The director has shot it, he has seen it, he knows everything, and he knows a lot more than I do. But I see what is on there. So I become the lawyer. I have to defend the material. So I have to be loyal to the material. I have to be loyal to what I see, what I feel, what it makes me feel, what it makes me think. I have to be loyal to that. And that doesn't always coincide with the loyalty for the director. And that's when the battle starts. That's when the real battle as an editor begins, when I have to make what I see in the material meet what the director set the minute he engaged me into the job or made a contract with me and told me about his visions and his dreams and we are going to make a film and it's going to be this and it's going to be that. And then
Sorry, I don't see it. But I see this. What about this? And it's not that I want to do another film. I just want to see how can we combine them, because otherwise we have a struggle. And that basically brings me to the bananas. I'm not going to talk a lot about the film, but I will just explain a little bit to give an example of this work, this ping pong between the editor and the director, because the bananas is a good example of that. Because the director called me and said, "Yes, but I found an amazing story. I'm already shooting. I'm going to Nicaragua tomorrow. When can we start editing?" And when he came back and we started looking at the material, I saw all his shootings from Nicaragua. I mean, more or less half of you have seen the film, was it so? And he said he was going to make a film about, you know, pesticides. It was banana workers in the third world country, in this case Nicaragua. But there was this landmark lawsuit, the first time that the third world, a third world worker had succeeded in raising a lawsuit against the big banana company called Dole on American soil. Instead of always these lawsuits ends up in the third world. And that was the interesting part. The point was that the director wasn't really super interested. He wanted to more use it as a framing. But he was more interested in all the chaos that decades of pesticides had left thousands of villages in Nicaragua in miscarriages, tons of different kinds of cancers, and everything. And when I started to look at this material, I said, I've kind of seen it before, we have heard it before, even though we had the lawsuit. And then suddenly, a DVD turned up on the table. It was a DVD from the courtroom, from the webcam in the courtroom. And that was the closing argument of the lawsuit. And I started watching that. The director knew we were going to use some of that, but he thought we could just use small bits and pieces. And that was the first time I had watched quite a lot of material at that point. And I said, "But Frederick, this is the first time I feel I am present where things are happening. This is like I'm the audience to a boxing match, because we have the fight between our hero, which was a lawyer who took on all these banana workers to try and run their cases. And then you also had the enemy. You had all the lawyers from Dole, so we were witnessing the entire battle. So I asked the director, "Where did you get that DVD from?" "No, they sell it from the webpage. The ones that are filming from the court, they stream it live and then they sell the DVD afterwards." I said, "Do they have the entire trial?" "Yes, they do, but what do you want to do with that?" "I want to watch it." 42 days of hearings and witnesses. And that's when we decided that this pesticide film was not going to be a pesticide film. It was going to be a courtroom drama. It took a little time to convince the director. I remember his initial reaction. It was, "But yes, but we shot in 2008. HD was pretty new. He had just bought this amazing HD camera and he was very fond of the very nice images he was shooting in Los Angeles and in Nicaragua. And then I came with this low-res webcam and I wanted to do the entire film with, or basically big parts of the film from this webcam." I said, "Yeah, but it's going to be great because it's going to be ugly to look at and everything, but it's the atmosphere is going to be amazing." So that was how we ended up with all this, and why there is so much webcam in the film for you who actually saw bananas.
I just went through here before we come. I'm gonna show. I just want to ask: are there anybody who watched Bananas who have some urgent questions to Bananas? Then you are very. Then it's now that you were gonna shoot. You are a very wise audience. When I watch the material for the first time, I am very, very focused on what it makes me think and what it makes me feel. I don't take a lot of notes. I've seen editors with notebooks that thick, but I don't. I trust my memory. I can later, 2, 3, 4 months later in the editing, I can still recall my first reaction to something, even though that emotion has gone because I've watched it so many times, but I have to recall that because I know that that's what the audience will feel. And that is what I work with as the editor. I have to think about the audience. How are they gonna think and feel in certain situations? I work with it. I know when to do certain things to make them feel certain things and to make them think certain things. I have to be able to anticipate their reactions, because if I'm behind the audience, they get bored. If I'm ahead of them, they get frustrated. I have to guide that, I have to reach out with that invisible hand that is guiding you through the film. And as an audience, you have to be captivated and feel safe that this film knows what it is doing. And everything that you as an audience is experiencing, it is giving me, you have to make them feel that it is the audience themselves that are making the discoveries. You cannot impose things. You just have to give the pieces of information in the right order for the audience to make the conclusions. If you make the conclusions for them, you get bored because you're feeling lectured. You're feeling that you are watching an educational film. You just have to find the pieces of information that gives the opportunity for the audience to follow your path. I am not a very spectacular editor. I am not the kind of editor that cuts a lot. I don't like to cut just because, now it's 3 seconds with this shot. Do we have another one? Let's put it in. Or establish a scenery and you use 6 or 7 shots. No, give me one good one, or 2 or 3. And that goes for dialogue, that goes for many things. So in that sense, I'm maybe a bit old school, but when you look at it from a documentary point of view, that's the way that you can turn documentary into a really cinematographic feeling. When every image has a meaning and bears an information, emotional or whatever, that's the reason to make a cut. To bring in a new angle, a new emotion, a new color, a new flavor, a new thought. Otherwise, stick to what you have. I will show you an opening, and then we can talk a little about it afterwards.
محمد تحكي لنا شوي هيك عن ليلة الاعتقال كيف كانت أو يوم الاعتقال.
يقول لي إذا أنت بتضرب حجار قل لي عشان أروحك وهيك.
الجندي كان بحكي لك هيك. ربطوك وغموا عينيك. وقعوك على إشي معين.
وقعت إشي بعرف شو. بالإبرة. عالسريع وقعت عشان أول مرة يعني. من اجت السيارة خشيت على السجن.
كيف بقوا يعاملوكوا في السجن؟
اللي بيغلط بتعاقب. وانا بقيت اغلط كثير.
وتعاقبت؟ كم مرة تقريبا؟
كثير تعديش.
كم مرة زارتك امك؟
مرة واحدة. لأنه سووا فيها إشي مش بعقل. هي المشكلة ما قالت ليش في الزيارة. بعد ما روحت ساعة قالت لي.
لو حكت لك شو كنت بدك تعمل؟
كان في راسي صار.
وقع مرة يجي يخدوك؟
يوم قال لي ايش قلت مش قلقان. انا هنا خشيت السجن اول مره عرفت شو السجن يعني اللي ياخذون الف مره بقلقش عرفت شو.
أهلا وسهلا فيكم. يعطيكم العافية. كيف أصبحتم؟
أصبحنا وأصبحنا الحمد لله.
اليوم هو لقائنا الأول عن برنامج الأشبال الأسراء المحررين من المعتقلات الإسرائيلية. تجربة الاعتقال هي من أصعب التجارب اللي بعيشها الإنسان في حياته. الأهم من هيك إنه إحنا كمان كأشخاص مرينا بهاي التجربة نعرف كيف إنه إحنا نقدر نتعامل مع هاي التجربة في المستقبل. فحابين شوية نعمل تمرين للتعارف. تحب تبدأ حمزة؟
حمزة محفوظ مخيم العرو قعدت 5 شهور ونص. كان عمري 16.
كان عمرك 16 سنة.
سامة بدودة 3 أشهر.
ليش كان عمرك يا سامة؟
15
سنة.
محمد جميل أبو ماريا بتمر 4 أشهر.
كديش كان عمرك؟
15 ونص.
15 سنة ونص لما اعتقلوك. شكرا.
مهران لافي 2 سنين. كان عمري 14 سنة.
14 سنة. شكرا يا مهران.
محمد جمال ابن ماري 4 شهور ونص. كان عمري 15
سنة.
Openings is very often the last thing I do. It's very difficult to make openings. And I, when I do workshops, I see so many times that I come out and I see maybe three half films that are opened in different ways and carrying in different directions. And my point is, I have met editors, who brilliant editors, who cannot edit a film without having an idea of the opening, to give a pace, to come into the film. I cannot. Simply because at that point in time, I don't know what the film is going to be. So how can I make the opening? I have to have the ending first. I have to have the whole path and all the dramatic movements before I can edit an opening. This one, I had more or less this idea, but I didn't really worry a lot about it. But I knew that this was a possibility. I wanted to create a space in this film, because the rest of the film is a lot of these therapy lessons that these kids go through. But I like these conversations that the, what's he called? Therapeut, what's the name? that he had, all these conversations were actually brief initial conversations that he had with the kids before he started the actual group therapy session. But I liked them a lot, these conversations, because the kids were very honest in those. So I said, if we open the film with one of those, then I have made a deal with the audience that this is the kind of film where suddenly people are talking on other images. That this conversation, it is a layer in this film. It is one of the elements. So I wanted to use it from the beginning. Then there are lots of plain scenes that are going on in present time and where we see when people are talking. But when I look into the material and try to see what is this film going to be about, I said yesterday, in the workshop to one of the films I was looking at, they said, don't worry too much about the house. You cannot start building a house without having built some bricks first. You cannot start building the entire film before you start making some bricks. And that's how I attack when we don't have a script. I attack the material. I look through, and when I see something that really appeals to me, I say, ah, that's a brick. I have no idea where it goes. But this is great. I loved that piece of conversation that he has with the boy. What did they do to you in prison? What did they say? And then I start making bricks. Try to find some pillars, important moments that really makes an impact. And then you get some bricks with flavors, colors, different forms. And when you start to have those, then you can start building your film and your house with those bricks. But you have to have of course, some kind of an idea what the film is about. But it is building the bricks that is important. And I think that comes from my experience in fiction, that I think in scenes. In workshops, I have many times seen films coming in and they're going, and they just carry on, one after another. There is never a break, there is never a stop. You have to think your film in a collection of small stories. And when you start combining them, then a whole universe starts emerging. I think I will show you the next scene, I'm gonna show you one more scene from the same film for another reason.
حمزة على الحجر اللي يضرب ابدا علام ادت اي يضل لك واحد مش قويه ايده حمزة بس بدها لده اذا صايبه
يا الله وقال علام اثنين
ورا قوتين ورا بعض في بكره مسيره زعلك
ترجع
سيارة سيارة وقف
شافوك زاطينك وبعدين طاخينك انت شارد حتى
مش انا
فاهمين بالله عليك هنو
بالسبع هذا
اللي. انت وياه قالوا لي
لا اول حانه مش انا
بدك شارد تبطل هالشيء هذا قلت لك اليوم هذا ما تطلعش ولا تروح ولا تيجي وانت بترد
صار شيء تمنى ما اطلعش واجي
شو خاصه اليوم هذا بتعرف انه بصير مشاكل شو بدي اضلني اقول لك انا اليوم ايه بنام مش بتعرف كمان قلت لي عشان يجي الجيش يعتقلوني ومن هالحكي
مسخره
لا مش مسخره فيش شيء بيطلع كذي
والله مسخره
لا فيش شيء بيطلع كذي
والله مسخره
اسعد لحظه في حياتك تتذكرها مره هيك شعرت فيها بسعاده بفرح
تنساها
نمرة واحد تمام
بقيت نايم ده بيجي المسؤول عنا غاد لو بقول محمد جميل تجهز تعليم نتعلم قلت اتوكل على الله غاد بتقول ليش توكل على الله بتتعاقب قلت اتوكل على الله ظل واقف قلت شو بدي اول مرة بسويها يعني ظل واقف لو بقول لي شو بدك تسوي قلت ده قوم اتوضى وصلي واتحمم واطي لا بقول لي طب يلا تحمام توضى وصلي وروح على الدار يوم قال لي تكيفت طبينا في بعضنا واللي عندي ورنيت على اهلي مصدقوش عياط صار عيط على التلفون من الفرح
لما وصلت البلد هون استقبلوك
هيك بقيت الناس أصابني مرض من التبوس المعام
سووا لك زفة
أنا سوا مع بعض بس بقى شعوري طاير في الهواء
بتشوف الناس من حواليك
كيف
يعني قادرين يحترموك زي الأول
أحسن صورت فيك
محمد الجوابرة، أهلا وسهلا فيكم. محمد هو روح قبل 4 أيام، عندك تجربة كمان طويلة. استقبلوك الشباب كيف؟ أنا بعيد شوي.
استقبال من الآخر، أعلام ومش عارف شو، أغاني وهيك أشياء.
لحظة بتنسهاش في حياتك. الحمد لله على السلامة.
الله يسلمك.
وأهلا وسهلا فيكم.
The reason why I showed you the opening, it was basically I wanted to show you. I forgot to say one thing. The punchline in the opening was, are you afraid of, what did he ask, something going back to prison, are you afraid of going back to prison? And what was the answer from the boy?
No.
I could go back 1,000 times because now I know what it's like. And that was the key for me to the entire film. Simply because this is the vicious circle. And that's what I wanted to explore through the entire film. And that was why I later in the film built this scene in from the same conversation. I just threw it in later. When he explains the joy of coming home, when he explains how he was received and how he's been looked at, the recognition, that's what I try to do there, is to kind of show these kids the identity of how they built up their identity, and that this cycle is very, very difficult to break. And that was why I picked this guy as the main character, because I had the option of picking any one of the 12, because the director hadn't made any decisions when she was shooting. When I watched the material for the first time, I try hard to get inside my characters, to understand them really as openly and without prejudice or anything. I try to fall in love with them, even love their flaws, their mistakes, their stubbornness, even if they have very, very unlikable characters. It's important for you to love your characters, because you have to defend them all the time. You can never make distance to your characters, because it will feel flat. You have to leave to the audience to think and make up their own opinions. Your job is to defend them and go along with their mindset. I had a problem with this scene, and it was actually just a few days before we closed the editing. I was lacking a scene. This strange opening scene where they are playing with the stones, I had watched it many, many times, but I didn't like it, because I think it was a little illustrational that now they are playing with the stones. The stones in this film was dead serious. So I didn't like them playing around, but I was lacking one moment for my main character. I was lacking the moment where he had to decide for the first time, am I gonna go back to a demonstration, or am I gonna be at home by myself? And I didn't have that moment. So I found in another dialogue in the material, I found this question from his friend: there's a demo tomorrow, are you gonna go? But I couldn't use the scene for many reasons, and that's when I went back to the playing with the stones, because I thought, okay, if I create a little moment where they innocently are playing with stones as kids are playing, And then I turn it into something serious in the end. That is why everything in the end is an off. You just see the two silhouettes of the guy sitting there, but the dialogue we are listening to. And then I have the close-up of the rock. He's playing, and suddenly the rock goes from being very playful to something extremely serious. Are you going to the demo? That's why it is important when you have your first rough version of your film, go back. Don't just think that you, in your first go, selected everything, because you only selected the most obvious parts. Now, when those parts are starting to make sense in your head and on the timeline, go back and watch again. Discarded material and see, oh, because suddenly you look upon it with new eyes. Because now you have a much bigger understanding of what the film that you are going to make and that you are in the middle of this process. Go back and investigate. And suddenly things that felt unimportant or suddenly you see the opportunity of turning them into something important and very useful within your timeline. Just find the space to put them in. I'm actually, also when I'm out at workshops, I often see that there is some kind of it's not a fear, that it's a documentary, so we cannot edit too much. When people speak, we have to be true to the way people are speaking and the way they are talking. And I totally disagree on that. I tear sentences to pieces and then I build and reconstruct my sentences. If I watch the documentary and I hear, that doesn't mean anything. I see a lazy editor that didn't took the time to remove that error. Or that repetition that doesn't bear any significance, because a repetition can bear significance, but not always. Very often they're just repetitions that are just a waste of time. Check it out. I cut a lot in interviews, dialogues, and build sentences that they never said. Because I need the information. I will come back to the information later on. But I like this editing. It is not just the story building, it is also this of suddenly tearing everything to pieces. For me, you know, words are, a letter is like a note, it's like a composer. And a word becomes a tone, you know, and a whole sentence becomes a tact. Be very precise with what people are saying. Really listen. Go back, listen again, and then you will discover that half of what they are saying could be omitted and you wouldn't miss it. Condense, condense, condense. Then you get this strong grip of the audience, and then you can also work with the pauses between the sentences, because when the sentences become exact and powerful and precise, they leave a resonance that you can enjoy. That's the kind of sentences you very often have in fiction films, in scripts. You always have the perfect sentences because they have been rewritten by 125 writers again and again and again to reach those precise messages that they both are emotional and informative at the same time. That's what we don't have in documentary. We just have hours and hours of words, and sometimes they just kill us. all the words, we don't need them. Tell it in another way. Like the homecoming scene, I call this the homecoming scene, my welcome home. Two-thirds of it is a visual musical journey with no explanation. I just give the explanation from my main character. He starts kicking off with the feeling of pride. And that goes into the rest of the montage. I'm going to shift to another film called Long Distance Love. And do I have to say anything? Yeah, I have to say very briefly, I have to introduce where we are. We are in a country called Kyrgyzstan. Do you know what that is? Former Soviet Republic, left in poverty and despair after the crackdown of the Soviet Union. So basically 25-30% of all young men, they immigrate on a very dangerous illegal immigrant journey, very often to Moscow. So the director had found this guy who had told him that he was going to make this journey. He just got married. His mother found a beautiful bride for him that he accepted. The bride moves in the house. And this is basically where we come in here.
Nima qilyapti?
Bilmam.
Qanday bir pasta edi.
Ata nima qo'ygizmi?
Ata nima? Kitobdan, o'sha Muhammad Aziz deganidek. Qiz bo'lsa Nodira deganidek.
İşin ağır. Dindiniz, kinel köp geladı. Yugur yugur. 300 sondan olasıdır hatta da 7 günde 300 son aladigan bolsan dir qot uni ola olmaymiz. Hozirgi momentda Alisherdan dir xatidan deri ish to'xtab qoldi. Sovuq tushib dadasiniki tendoli yana nima bo'lib qoldi deb ishga kirdim-da. Dollarini qiylandi doqqatdim. Erim O'zbekistonda ishlardi. 15 kunda dir kelardi, 2 kun kelib ketardi. Menga dir tinim ko'rsatmasdi. Shunda ham tuling qani deganda sizdan hozir ham so'raningdan tulini. Nana kecha to'ydan chakkandan asti nayda chidatib keldim, Yulduz. Xonasini naqa irg'itib yubordi. Men to'ydan keldim deb qolgan dedi, deb turibchi mana nada irg'itib yubordi. Nana ashin qand qo'slarini oldinglarga olib kelib chiroyli qilib qo'ysam bo'lardi. Shunaqa chiroyli qandlardi. Toza rossiyskiy qandlardan olib keldim. Xonasini nashadan irg'itib yubordi. Ko'ryapman mana televizorlarda ko'rsatadi qanday qiylanib, qanaqa qilib turmush qurib, qanaqa qilib qiylanib bolachaqa boqqan. Keyin rohatini ko'rib qolganlarni ko'rib turib, ajonasni yana shularga o'xshab, keyinchalik shunaqa rohatda o'tirib qolardikindan. Dinanda. Tech yashib ko'kalanzor yer ketib, o'sha yerda tech o'tirsa, menga hech kim o'sha yerda qilmasa. İşte kan havalıp kaldım hazır.
This interview, it is actually an interview with the mother. A very long interview, and it goes deeper and deeper, and she's actually on her way of talking about that she dreams of taking her life. And if I had discussion with the director, I said, we cannot use that. Because the film is not about that. I wanted her despair and her hopelessness to land on the shoulders of my main character, the young Alisher, who is just about to become a father. So he now has to make a decision. And this is the moment where he makes the decision. Most of the film actually goes on in Moscow, because we follow him to Moscow on his journey as an illegal immigrant. But you have to be very, very aware with your point of view in the scenes. Be careful that they don't steal the picture. Every time you have to have your main character in your mind. So even though that Alisher is not, as he's called, present in this scene, we know it is all about him. Everything leads directly to him and his decision about me leaving his pregnant wife. I had a problem with the interview. I didn't know, because we had a goal with this film to make it as cinematic, as fiction-like as possible. But obviously you cannot avoid the interviews. The director is a brilliant interviewer. But then I found these images of the daughter-in-law who had just moved in. So I called the scene, "Welcome to the family, Dildora." And that's how I work with my little post-its. Whenever I build a brick, I turn the brick into a post-it. But be very careful what you call those. I don't know if you work the same way to try and have an order, but I've seen many editing rooms with post-its all over the wall. And that's wrong. Because when you come in there, it is like the film is just, it is too overwhelming, and the film is too dark, it's a dark monster that you cannot control. You have to be in control of the process. So with the post-its, it is not mother is talking about it is very hard to work. No, it is not. What is the main core of the scene? It helps you when you write these post-its. It's a wonderful exercise, at least for me. Because it makes me focus. What is the scene really about? 3 words, Jesper. 4 maximum. 5 sentences on a post-it, it doesn't work, I can't even read it. 3-4 words. It is possible with every scene to do that. And when you can do that, that's when you understood what you are doing. And that's when you can finish editing it. I was lucky to find these images of the daughter-in-law from her interview. So I could make it into this conversation. She's a very humble character, so that she didn't have strong reaction. It didn't bother me, because it goes with her character. The main point for me by showing this clip, it is because it is an example of what I would call disguising boring information as a dramatic scene. And you have to do a lot of that to maintain the drama and the interest in your film. Because what one thing we always struggle with, the documentaries, and when I sit there building my bricks, it's information. We need so much information. In scripts, all the information are elegantly written into the sentences, so we don't realize when we are being lectured, when we are being fed important information. It's brilliantly constructed, but we don't have that in documentaries. We have all these words. You have to find a way to dramatize them. You have to create a little emotional moment. You can use whatever. In this case, I used this poor mother's despair to give me an update. What is the situation in the family? Alicia doesn't have work. I'm the only one. I'm sick. I have to work because the fuck of a husband, he doesn't do anything except complain. Thank you. But I didn't realize, you know, when you watch the scene, you don't realize that you are being lectured, because things that we dislike in documentaries, it is what I call these victims' stories. Oh, I am so poor, I don't have this, or I have it. No, we don't want these complaints. There is so much complaining in documentary, and it's boring. Because it is read, you read it like this. You just need the word boring. Of complaining, we don't want complaining. Out with complaining, you have to find another way of telling it. So you have to create these small moments that gives you an emotional air. Or break or pause, where you squeeze in and you drop in these little pieces of information that you need. I need to talk about how are we doing time-wise, because we were a little bit late when we started.
We have 20 minutes. 20-25 maximum.
Okay, then I have to skip a clip. Okay, fine. No, I want to talk about arcs, because that's another one of my mantras. When I start to build and put a few bricks together and create a little part that has some kind of a flow, like this sequence you saw here. It is what I call an entire arc. What was the first shot? I didn't hear it, sorry.
The mule went in bed.
No.
The clock. Oh, yeah. Clock.
What?
Clock.
Maybe it's because I don't understand the word.
Watch.
Ah, the clock, yes. I forgot about that. I'm very sorry. It is because my quick time was unprecise. No, it was because of the music. I wanted you to remember this scene. The dead factories. The country that has stopped, that has frozen, nothing happens. It is basically just geography. But with those images, I set the entire scene, I set the entire tone. This is what it's about. Everything is frozen, even the family. And what's the last in this arc? The factories again. And the journey within that arc, it is the description of the hopelessness of the family, and somebody has to do something about it. So when an arc finishes, something new has to happen. And what is the first thing that happens after this? It is Alicia making a decision, going to an agency, trying to find out, how can I get to Russia? Even though that it implies that I have to leave my pregnant wife. And that is what happens at that moment. A new arc starts building up. I spent a lot of time when I have my first rough version trying to understand what the fuck I'm doing. To see where do I have these arcs? Because you have one big arc, which is the film, from the opening to the ending. But you have a lot of small arcs within that. Some people talk about the famous three-act drama. You have three arcs there, but you have a lot more. You even have arcs within a scene. A scene, very often, if you try to analyze them, very often a scene that works rhythmically well, it has three arcs. There is something about three that is wonderful when you are constructing story. There is something there, one, two, three, and then something new. One, two, three, buff, and then something new. The whole structure is a lot of those small arcs. Be aware of them, because when you start to figure out where they are, that's when you start to understand the structure of your film. And that's when you can start and go in with the next level of refinement of your story, the final, the rhythm, the pacing. But you cannot do that before you have really understood exactly what you are doing at every spot on your timeline. You have to. And that's the point when you get the story inside your body. I sometimes get a little bit annoyed when I talk with directors very long time into the editing, and I realize by discussing some topics within the film that they don't know the order of the scenes. I dream the order of the scenes. I can tell them in the morning in the shower, I know exactly the order of the scenes. And you have to know exactly the order of the scenes. Because that's the only way you are really in control of what you're doing. No, I just wanted to give this one with the three-act structure. Because there is a famous saying, and that explains a lot of the classical drama building, that in the first act, you get your main character up in the tree. In the entire second act, you do nothing but throwing stones at him. And in the third act, you try as gracefully as possible to get him down the tree again. That is the Western storytelling, with that little story, basically. And this is basically the story of the long-distance love. I'm sad I have to skip a clip now. I have a clip from Moscow. I'm just going to tell you briefly, because this is the whole second act in this film. It is all his struggle in Moscow. Now we got him up the tree. Mother got him up the tree. Now we start throwing stones at him. And my God, that poor boy, he gets a lot of stones. He even misses the birth of his firstborn child, even though that was the promise he made when he left. And then another thing I work with before the last clip, I'm going to say a little thing. Have you heard about setups and payoffs? Because that is really the structure in our storytelling. Whenever audience are losing track of what the film is about at a certain point, when you have screenings, for example, say, no, I don't know this scene with the mother complaining, I don't know, really, I was kind of lost, I found it a little bit boring. Very often, it is not that scene that is any problem with. It's 3-4 minutes before that it's the problem. Because, basically, it has not been set up correctly. So we don't have any expectations to go into it. So I'm kind of lost when I'm like, what the fuck am I doing here? And then you lose it. Or when we have payoffs and you realize with a test audience, ah, they didn't get that. Ah, they didn't get this and that. No, they didn't get the payoff because it wasn't set up earlier. You have to throw in all these small signals. In this one, I'm working with the father as a figure. We hardly see the father in the entire film, but he's there as a ghost, as a dark ghost, all the time. And now that we come to the end scene, I'll tell you why. Because I'm gonna show you my poor little hero, Alicia, is now back home. He has just come home and realized what has happened while he was gone. That his family lost their house because of father's drinking and very stupid, almost gambling investments. And he discovers a few more things. He has had a terrible time, 8 or 9 months in Moscow at that point, and doesn't really want to go back. I think that's all you need to know.
Meni qaytib ketasan? Men qolasan.
Men bilmadim.
Bir bo'lsa ketaman, bir bo'lsa ketmayman. Uylarni ashirdi, uylarni qolib ketadi, tantasini o'lasi bo'lasilar qolib ketadi deb o'yladim.
O'yladimmi? Ashing uchun jo'natgim kelmasdi. Tezroq kelsin derdim.
Qolib ketganmi ular? Uylarni qolib ketgan.
Borardim.
Qanaqa qildim?
Topardim.
Qanday topardim?
Topardim-da.
Yaxshi emas, shunaqa bo'lganmi?
Bo'lib ishlatib qoldim.
Yaxshi, mana qilmagan.
Sabzavotlar nima ta'mi deb turadi.
Chamasa, rejimda dostlar.
Puxtayib qo'yib turib to'lasha olmadi. Ammo
oxirini noyidi totdim, so'randim uyda egasiga bordim. O'tirib turari to'lat, o'tirgan yerimda suv qotilidan pulga zarq qolib, 1.5 mingdan berasan deb turib oldi.
Nimaga men ashini men telefonda aytmadinglar? Ashni mahalda telefonga aytib turib, o'g'lim, manaqa bo'ldik. Nima qilib har oyda jo'natib tur
derdi-ku. Ali tur jo'natgan turlaring Danisaga yoting deb jo'natgan pulingni ham Danisaga yotish kvartiraga to'ladim-da men osh og'ir ekanidan to'lanadim, osh yotmadim. Nonda lichinolatdan deb qo'ydim.
Al danam kelsin o'tirib gaplashaman men. Hozir hozirmi cho'ntagida 50 so'm puli bor, ichib keladi hozir. Hozir ketdimi telefon aytib? Hozir ichib keladi.
Сука.
Энди ён сен дилетин катарны барып, яна кайты ишлат. Уни озгина тулны жолату ди таласынан Дилдорхан кеде такни кыян ерде Дилдорхан нана деген экенсен.
Мен ойламай, мен ойламай, озинан ойла. Мен ойламай, мен ойламысла ойламайла, мен узум ойлама. Мен башы ойлама ойламай.
Дүйеге борсан ханас башы ятып ятыра дияна. Үйді yok қыл дей, үйді yok қыл дей. Кечіден қол дей, бір yola дей. Бағы еді сан яра бағыйды. Борсан яра сөкші ештіп қайтып келі яқта. Кечік кечен аш ічімді иттат әлі яқ. Үйдегілерге яма көрініп әді келім мәне, шу ауалге түшіп қалдым.
Yeah.
dert bilan unga deraylik. Ol donuda, derdim. Men saylananlar der. Seniz tashosh bu, ha?
Mənim görüb tutanı məşinə qədər iş. Məşinəni şuna qalıb, şuna qalıb, şuna qoyamız. Quru barda güyləri də, onunla yuşayın. Rəsiyyədən görə yaqında, qısqası. Rəsiyyədə uzaq, baramıysan, geləmıysan. Mən kepsəm mənə, işgədə.
Şu yerde yataslarım, şu yerde.
Kirimiz olsun mu, huzur var mı? Bir yıl hep çömür müyümüz? Ya, azlaştım ya, bir yıl hep çömür müydü kendi boylamayı. Her bazı daha iş görüp, bayna düşüp, çömürüp çıkıyoruz. Baynamızı yakın o yerde. Rastım yok.
Doğalasa ikinci balamız ham bo'ladi. Bo'lmib qopti.
Qanaqa?
Shunaqa.
Ikkinchi bola?
Ikkali.
Yaxshi, yaxshi, yaxshi. Bordi.
Bishkekga aylantirib chiqasiz. Bishkekga birinchi marta kelishingiz.
Ettadan bo'shmasman deb qo'yibmanda. Bugun mayli aylantirib qo'yaman. Endi poyezdda bor ekan endi mayli, nima qilamiz? Ashna mahalda xo'p deb turmasak endi boshqa mahallaga jiling deb qo'yamiz. Ayrıca ki toplayalım. Bir sen plan verin.
Doğru bulduk. Taşın akıl işe gelirdi size.
Thank you.
It was the last scene I wanted to show you, because I remember when I saw that scene for the first time. Him sitting in the cafe. And suddenly I heard, it's in the recording, I heard this harmonia? I heard that music, and then suddenly this old man with his maybe son goes through begging for money, stops. Alicia is like this, and I couldn't believe the shot. The director made a very good, because this is actually shot directly after this, he has been updated on the poor family situation. And there is a brilliant interview with Alicia there. And I was editing several versions where he had to reflect upon the whole situation. What are you going to do, Alice? Are you going to go back? What about your wife? And what about this? What about that? But in the end, I took it all out because I said, it's all there. Alicia's decision was the yellow label on the wall. That was the moment when Alicia realizes that he can never change his father. He can never change his mother. He has only one thing to do, think about himself. He saw this ghost, he saw his father and himself, he saw himself becoming his father. Because that's what I built up during the entire Moscow sequence. He goes into drinking, he goes into, I mean, he works, he manages to send a little money home. But he is a very big disappointment to himself. And when he comes home, he realizes he can become his father, or he can do something else. And he chooses to leave again. But this time not that far away. I wanted you to see it as an example of, very often you don't need the words. Make me make the conclusions. But this was one of the breaks I was aware of very, very early. I was not quite sure how I was going to use it. But I could also have used it in the beginning, where I have him sitting with the factories. It is the exact same situation I could have put in there, after the mother's speech. Before I wrap up, I want to hear if you have any questions out of the blue you want to ask, even if it's not related, just related to your situation also. You have different background as me, yes?
How do you deal with the foreign dialogue? Is it all subtitled when you get it?
No. This was hell. Simply because they are speaking a dialect that very few people are speaking. We had problems finding somebody that spoke English that could make trustable transcripts. Because it's very, very tricky doing transcripts. But I want transcripts. And then later on, when I don't subtitle at all. I don't subtitle at all. I select parts from transcripts that then get subtitled.
Okay, but the transcripts have some kind of time code, so you can follow or?
Yeah.
Okay.
In the best of situations, yes. Not always. But I do, because I work a lot on, I have edited in so many different languages. I actually had a situation in this film where I had to select material to be transcribed, because we could not transcribe it all. So I had to watch without knowing what they said. I picked scenes. I said, this, something is going on there. Transcribe that, okay, out. Something is going on there. So we had actually to omit some parts because it was not manageable to get it all transcribed.
But then it's also hard to do the sentences cutting.
Yes, that's the problem when you are not really familiar with the language. Yes, that's a problem. Very often I get somebody with the right language in the editing room at some point to help me with that. But that is a problem when you have somebody that doesn't understand the language that you end up with these long sentences because nobody dares to touch them because they don't know where. It's very dangerous, especially when you want to create a film in the style that this one was. Anything else? Yes?
How important is the music in your montage? Do you like center a piece on a music piece? When you build it, when you are building a block,
yeah.
Do you build around the song?
No, but I sometimes I edit scenes to a piece of music, and then when I finish the scene, I take the music away. I find a piece of music that I think fits emotionally somehow in there, because music has this wonderful thing. It has a structure that helps you sometimes to find a structure in a very long narrative. And sometimes it can be difficult, and music can help you. So if you have a music that goes in, let's say, three small waves, and you put it on a dialogue, you would suddenly, because you put the music on, you will realize that the dialogue is too long. When you edited the dialogue without music, there is a logic. There is an A, B, C, D, E, F, G in the whole building up of that dialogue. But sometimes it doesn't hurt to suddenly take out E and F and just have a jump. And music helps you sometimes to find those places, because the music are suggesting, there's something in the music that is suggesting something new has to happen. And then I look at my timeline in the dialogue, oh shit, I have three more lines before I have the change in the dialogue. Try to take them out and see if it works. Very often you will be surprised. So I also use the music sometimes to help me condense thick scenes that I have problem intellectually to get into and really decide what is going to miss here. Music can be helpful. So I use it a lot and take it away, but I use quite a lot of music in my films, I must say, generally. It's a matter of taste. And I have big struggles with composers. Yeah?
What is the first thing that you do when you enter the editing room for the first time and you're faced with this endless amounts of material? What is the first thing? How do you approach it? The first time that you're faced with...
After I attacked the director. I have a Swedish director that I've worked a lot with. He's actually director of this film, The Long Distance Love. And he once said to me, because I wasn't aware of it, and he said, Jesper, it's amazing, because we have now done, I don't know if it was 7 or 8 films at that point in time, and the scenes you start editing when you enter the editing room are very often the scenes that ends up being kind of the pillars in the film, the important scenes, the scenes that you would maybe remember, the scenes that really has to be, but then that is the moments I'm looking for. For the first time, I'm looking for moments that really gives a strong impact on me. I say, oof, this is important. The film cannot be without this. I don't know, I have no clue where it goes. So I try to look for those. That's what happened with Bananas. I looked through a lot of material from Nicaragua, and I could see that there were things, but it needed a lot of work, and I didn't really see the horizon. So I skipped it. And I kept on looking, and then I went to the LA material with the lawyer, and I looked, okay, interesting, fascinating, and then I got the DVD. And that's when it hit me. Bam! More of this. So I tried to look for them, and then I kind of put the other things. I can see that there are stuff in there, but I put them a little aside. But I tend to attack the stronger moments. So these are the first post-its I put on the wall. So I have 1, 2, 3, maybe 5 strong moments. And that's how you can start building your story.
But first you look
before. With those five moments, forget about all the information and all this stuff that you have to build up. Forget about those. Think about what happens to a story if it starts with the mother dreaming of committing suicide. If I take that note and place it as the first one, what does that do to the order of the four other strong moments I have? And you try to find a logic there. Then you take note number four and say, no. Let's start with the pregnancy, if that was a big moment. What happens to the story? Your point of view changes. Even your main character might change sometimes when you swap those moments around. That's what helps me. And then you can see that it is, you're kind of building a skeleton. And then you start putting on all the meat. When you are sure of that skeleton, and you can see there is a journey here, that's when you're okay. What do we then need? Okay, I need to explain this, and I need to explain this, I need to explain this. But you can now place all these more informational parts because you have the pillars. Now you know what do you need to know before the suicide and what goes after. Does it make sense? Because this is why I love the workshops, because you always have something concrete. It is very abstract to talk about that the editing part, but I think this is a very basic version of, if I have a method, it must be that. I don't know what all the other editors, what methods they have. I really don't, because I've never talked to them. I never went to film school because of that special journey I made. So I never made it to film school, so I don't have this classical method. And now I'm getting the suicide. I just want to end with one story about him that I remember from a very famous editor called Walter Mersch. You know him? He's also a little, I think he was a scientist too, actually. No comparison. He calculated, when he edited Apocalypse Now, after he calculated how many edits he had done during a day. It was a huge journey to edit that film. Do you know what it was? 1.47. So then he said, my God, he worked 12 hours. I spent 12 hours in the editing room making 1.47 cut every day for, I think he edited, I don't remember how many, it was more than a year he edited, I think it was almost a year and a half. So it teaches us, it's the process. It's all about the process. Going through. Don't be afraid of that monster of material that is around you. Just dive into the process with an open mind. And you see an ocean of opportunities, and you don't see a shitstorm of limitations. I think that's the best advice I can give. Is that it, honey?
Unfortunately.